So it's with great pleasure and delight that I introduce to you Bill Nye.
Tap then blow, everybody. It's good advice in so many things. Don't just go exhaling onto the microphone, and I think it's boosted. You could turn it down a schmink. Yes, hi, let's open this. Hi, everybody. For those of you who do not know, I have done other things besides be on Dancing with the Stars. I was there briefly. And these people, I know we have things to do. I was really excited about this talk until really just a few minutes ago. Do we have power?
We don't have power. Do
you have power? We'll see what happens. We'll run a test.
Oh, we ran power.
It's down here with the heavy cord. I was excited about this talk until really right as dinner started. And then it changed. Somebody came up to me and said, "Is Bill Nye your real name?" And I said, "Well, it's William Nye." And he said, "Well, why did you change it?" I thought, man, it's going to be going to be at this a while. Use your critical thinking skills. Get in there. All right, here we go. 3, 2, 1. Yeah. All right, there we go. There's a lot of my life right there. Okay, steady. Yes! Greetings, humanists. Yes. This is Mars. Actually, it's a picture of Mars. I don't think Mars would even fit in this room, tell you the truth. It's big. It's a planet. Because I think it's going to work now. Wait, where are you? Steady. Be cool. Wait. Yes. Okay. Yes! Yes! All right. We did the opening joke about the person asking my name. Okay. Then did we do the thing about Mars wouldn't fit in this room? We covered that. Okay, so I will now for a few minutes finally talk some more about me. I, like many of us, am a result of two humans who interacted. Can we say interacted on television? No, the fear is this is being recorded, and I got to say to everybody here, it's quite a relief. I do a lot of talks at colleges, and when you're in my position here in the front of the room, you look out, most people are not looking at me. They're looking at the back of their phones. So it's nice to see a few of you engaged in what I like to call monotasking. So this is my father. Actually, it's a picture of my father. He wasn't that tall. And he was quite the rock hound, quite the amateur geologist, and he often referred to himself as Ned Nye, boy scientist. I know many of you have day jobs, but I just pointed out where the rocks are in this picture. I know some people will miss them. Let me move this a little closer. Yeah, there we go. And my mother, shown here, my mother was recruited by the Navy. She went to Goucher College, which is back when they had such things, was the sister school to Johns Hopkins. It's in Baltimore. Now it's outside of Baltimore, and you know, they let boys in. It's gone to heck. But dean of women, the dean of students, dean of women, Dorothy Stimson, was the first cousin of the Secretary of War Stimson, and he apparently, this is the old days, asked her if she had any women that can come work on this thing. I can't tell you what it is. So she worked on the Enigma code in World War II, and it's the family myth that she was recruited because she was good at math and science. It seemed like she was, but you know, you're a kid, you take her word for it. And I met several of these women over the years, and you would say to them, hey, what did you do during World War II, which was the touch point for people of that era. Oh, I can't talk about it. Can't talk about it. And they were declassified in 1992. And just notice that Secretary of Stimson was the Secretary of War, not the Secretary of Defense. Yeah, like they called, if you will, a war back in those days. And just if you don't know who she is, with all due respect, I met several of the other ladies over the years. Really, really, who is the hottest woman? I mean. Who's got the gams, really? I'm not trying to be a jerk. My mom, she happens to be standing next to the war hero. It's all good. So I was a result of the Ned Nye boy scientist and my mother, the cryptographer. And I had this moment as a kid. I delivered the Washington Post. I was a paper boy back, a paper deliverer. And in Sunday paper, Ripley's, believe it or not, was in color. And they ran this story several times, and I contacted Ripley's, and they're very gracious. They sent it to me electronically. Insects, which have been flying for some 350 million years, defy the laws of aerodynamics. The bumblebee, considering its size and shape and wingspan, is an aerodynamic misfit and should be unable to fly. And I was a little kid. And it's in the paper. And it's Ripley's Believe It or Not, where they have the guy who died from laughing, and the guy who was able to sleep with his eyes open, and all these extraordinary things. And they got bumblebees cannot fly. And then I went outside to the azalea bushes, and I spent a long time watching bees. I mean, I got to the point where I was pretty sure I was watching the same individual, the same girl bee coming and going from the azalea bushes, and I realized bees fly fine. The problem is the theory. And this really was an enormous turning point for me, that you don't have to take everything that grown-ups tell you as true. I found that's still good advice. So this has led to a whole series of kooky things that have gotten me involved with you all, and it's really an honor to be asked to address you. A few years ago, I was on television with Jerry.
What?
Yeah. Well said, yeah. Jerry Falwell. She said, what? Yeah. No, it was at that time he was alive. Okay. All right. So just, you know, let's... Don't want to get too weird on you, but this was this hilarious Easter thing, and somebody the early show had this great idea to have, let's have everybody talk about Easter, and the question was, what came first, the chicken or the egg? And Jerry Falwell, you know, quoted some passage from the Bible and so, and then Judy Gold would make some miserable... let's say she was critical of Reverend Falwell. And then I pointed out that it's a science question. It really is a science question. If you're literally asking which came first, the chicken or the egg had to come first. I mean, I can't help you here. Because whatever was before the egg had to not quite be a chicken. Had to be some proto-chicken. Some pre-chicken. And a pre-rooster. Very close, probably, to a rooster, but not literally what we would think of as a rooster. And this fundamental science idea was lost on these people. And I'm over there just so excited about it. Look, my hands are moving. Look at me. I'm just thrilled. And they're just looking at me like I am from some other, I'll go planet, yeah, some other place. And then, maybe you've heard about this, many years ago, I was at McLennan Community College, which is in, it's real near Crawford, Texas. It's in Waco. It's in Waco, Texas. And I pointed out that whoever had written the first part of Genesis, at least as it's translated in English, was probably not aware that the moon does not make its own light. God made the sun to light the day and the moon to light the night. And I pointed out to the audience that this was probably whoever wrote this or translated it really didn't get that. And indeed, a woman in the audience grabbed her two children. I presume they were her children. I don't know if they were. Grabbed two kids by the wrists and dragged them out, asserting that, you know, we believe in God, and so we can't cotton to this crazy idea that the moon doesn't make its own light. And so that people are, I mean, we're not going to change that woman's mind. I mean, she's set, she's fine. I mean, she's probably seen pictures of guys walking on the moon and noticed that the ground isn't glowing. But has never taken that moment to appreciate that the Bible is, or at least as translated in English, is inconsistent with that observation. And so we got to let her go. I mean, we're not going to change her. But it's the kids that I'm so concerned about, because they are the future of taxpayers and voters. And Zach is here. He's got the millennial anger right on, man. Another thing that happened to me much more recently, I won't say an offhanded remark, but I was musing about creationism for a journalistic online internet distribution of news company called Big Think. And I remarked that it's okay if you are a grown-up and you want to have a worldview that's completely inconsistent with everything we observe in nature. That's fine. No, really. I mean, we're not going to change this woman's mind or certain people's mind. Their minds are made up. The Science Guy show, looking at the audience, I would say most of you are not of the age to have watched the Science Guy show. But it was you guys right on. I love you, man. Men, woe man. Hey, you in the back, yes, welcome. Wow, look at you all. I love you, man. Womans, the show was designed for people who are in fourth grade, 10 years old, not for any other reason. I mean, not just that my understanding's about there, but there's a very compelling study that 10 years old, fourth grade, is about as old as you can be to get a so-called lifelong passion for science. And I'll bet you it's as old as you can be to get a lifelong passion for anything. Like Joe, award winner, you probably loved storytelling when you were a kid, right? Yeah. Yeah, yeah. And so, Gina, you had a fascination, was it with teeth? when you were a kid. And so, this sticks with you the rest of your life. So, we aimed the show at people 10 years old, and that turned out to be a pretty good age for most everybody. The difference between somebody who's 10 years old and a grown-up is really not much more than a grown-up's experience. The grown-ups have a lot more experience than 10-year-olds generally. But here's the thing that I find so striking about this, everybody, and this is why I'm so glad you're here and we're taking this meeting. Look in the lower right. There's been, since yesterday afternoon, there have been 5,800,000 views. And it's just me sitting in a chair, and I could say, I know in this room it's being recorded, I could easily say something could end my career, but I'd gotten up at 5:30 in the morning New York time, which was 2:30 Pacific time, And so I won't say I was taken off guard, but I just said what I thought, that if you're a grown-up and you want to go off and believe this, inconsistent with nature idea of creationism, that's okay, but don't make your kids do it, because we need taxpayers and voters. And so I say to creationists of all ages, what is it? What is it that you find so compelling? What is it that makes you so into this? And all I can think, everybody, is we, or I, as a science educator, have failed. That if you look at the evidence in nature, it's stunning. It's overwhelming. It's wonderful. If you look at the periodic table, there's a lot of things you can do. But the one we just, everybody who's into this knows and loves, my father, the rock hound, is rubidium becomes strontium. Come on! Rubidium becomes strontium. And it does so with its extraordinary half-life. Almost 50 billion years. You can do it for decades. They observe these minerals. They do them cold. They do them hot. They do them in a vacuum. I don't know if they do them underwater, but they probably do. And the rate doesn't change. And so when you find rubidium becoming strontium and you have this half-life, you can work backwards and figure out how old the Earth's got to be. Why you would run around and want the Earth to be 10,000 years old and try to reconcile that is just amazing. It's really amazing. And you got to appreciate, I feel, that we have to appreciate that people have already embraced that. We're not probably not going to change their minds. We got to work, this is I say all the time, we got to work on the young people. Now, for those of you who saw the game last night, I know many of us pride ourselves on being detached from popular culture, but the World Series is being played, and just I put in parentheses, it's baseball, for those of you who don't know. All right. And I was listening on the radio last night, and this was a turning point where the throw to the plate, but it's home plate, bottom of the diamond there. The throw was missed, and Salty Amakia threw the ball over the third baseman, and people started running around. But the night before was a turning point for me. Dan Clark, and a lot was made on the internet, this isn't my business, They billed him as a retired sergeant from the Marine Corps, but I guess he's not strictly retired. He was honorably discharged, and he was given special special permission to wear the uniform, and he sang God Bless America. Now, there's a lot of things that bug us all, but God Bless America, it's just, I mean, it's Major League Baseball. They're a private organization. They can do whatever they want. But it's not the same as if you sang if we were to sing a different song together. And I can show you this by means of a thought experiment. It's very popular for people who support the singing of this sort of song at baseball games, nominally the national pastime. It's very popular to say, well, this represents monotheism, and then we're all in this together. No matter what God you're into, it's all the same. We should all join in this and celebrate our oneness with the universe and so on. But suppose during interleague play, and for those of you who are detached from popular culture, there is an American League and a National League, and it was just during June they would have the leagues. Suppose we changed it during interleague play to Buddha Bless America. It might actually even fit the music a little better with two syllables. And along that line, it could be Allah Bless America. Or maybe if you want to just go with one syllable, Zeus Bless America. And if we were to do this, people would recognize right away that this is troubling. But I got to tell you all, I don't think it's going to happen. We got to let that one go. If people want to sing that, let them sing it. But it's a good time for me and my colleagues to go to get a hot dog or some other traditional popcorn. some other traditional ball game activity, or catch up on your score sheet. Now, I travel quite a bit. Does anybody remember Dan River Fabrics? Anybody? Yeah, yeah. So it's Dan River Fabrics used to be, guess where they were located? On the Dan River, yes. And Dan River is in Danville, Virginia. And I took this picture, I admit, with my phone, and I did my best, so I've typed it up here. In front of the church, this is the Westover Church of God, it says, Big Bang Theory, you must be kidding me, God. It just breaks my heart. Why do you think we have the Big Bang Theory? I mean, it's a very good show. I'll give you that. Oh, by the way, let's talk some more about me. I will be on the Big Bang on the 7th of November. Yes. And you guys, I'm in a scene with Bob Newhart. I mean, the guy can just lay it down. He's just, oh, he's so funny. It was really an honor. So the 7th of November, don't miss it if you can. Wait, yeah, okay. So what I have done as a science educator is failed, that these people think that the Big Bang, the idea of the Big Bang is so extraordinary that it couldn't possibly be true. Well, everybody, if we go back to the periodic table, this is the periodic table that I have on my business card. Well, it's the back of my business card. And I have, you have to make, you can make a lot of design decisions when you do a periodic table. So everybody who's radioactive has this bubbly background. All the ones that are liquid at standard temperature and pressure, that's just two of them now, bromine and mercury, they have this dark blue. There's one that sublimes at room standard temperature and pressure. Anyone? I failed. It's iodine or iodine, number 53. There has to see some red bars that represent vapor. Okay, Bill, that's great. But if you, the thing I wanted to point out is I've separated hydrogen. If you talk to a normal person, like a chemist, hydrogen donates a proton. It makes an acid. It's great. Who doesn't love hydrogen? If you talk to a crazy person, like an astrophysicist, hydrogen is a metal and has metallicity. And it's like conducts electricity and stuff. So I put it off to the side there on its own. But appreciate that when it comes to the universe, it's almost all hydrogen and helium. That's all we got. And there must be some reason for that. By the way, the stuff that you and I are made of, things that we breathe like oxygen and carbon and sulfur and phosphorus and iron and all those other wonderful even-numbered elements, I just call those everything Elsium. And so appreciate that's only, it's barely 2% of the observable universe. And so when Edwin Hubble goes to the top of Mount Wilson near Pasadena, California, and sees the stars moving apart, and sees that they're a little redder than he would have expected, he realizes the universe is expanding. Then later astronomers infer that it's not only expanding, it expanded from a place all at once, and that's the Big Bang. And nobody, why do you think they make that up? Because that's what they see, for crying out loud. And so this idea that what we observe is why we have these things people call theories is just lost on so many voters and taxpayers, and we're not going to get them back. We got to work on the young people. So if you were to show this picture to my father, no, not to my father as much, my grandfather, he would have thought you had made it up. And he'd wonder what was in the foreground. That's the International Space Station, actually a picture of the International Space Station. It's quite a bit bigger than that, yeah. Has anybody ever been there? Yeah. It's expensive. Anyway, did you everybody see Gravity? Did you have fun? Yeah, it's okay, right? You just can't fly from one. It's really hard. You need a lot of delta V, as we say, a lot of change in speed. Anyway, if you were to show this to my grandfather, first of all, he he wouldn't quite believe it. The other thing, it looks like the Earth is out of focus. But the Earth isn't really out of focus. That's the atmosphere. That's the whole thing. So if you could somehow get an extraordinary car on some extraordinary road and drive straight up, you'd be in outer space in barely an hour of freeway, hour and a half of freeway driving. You'd be, well, in California, you'd be up 20 minutes of freeway driving. You'd be in outer space. And this is the thing that has affected me my whole life. What I call our place in space. This crazy, this astonishing fragility, the delicate nature of the Earth. And we are living at a time where things are changing. And this goes so far back with me, everybody, through a remarkable clerical error. I attended Cornell University. And I'm sure it was just a huge mistake on their part. And at one point, I took astronomy from Carl Sagan. Did you put it back? Yeah, whatever. I was one guy in the back of the room. I mean, he was not my best buddy or anything, but I met him later on at my 10th reunion, and then it turned out his son, Sam, watched the Bill Nye show. He liked it. So Carl Sagan writes to me and says, "Also, I thought I found a few conceptual errors." Now, you guys, I know the young people, you may not know who Carl Sagan was. You know who Neil deGrasse Tyson is, everybody, young people? He was Neil deGrasse Tyson in 1980, okay? 1980, it was when disco was becoming new wave and punk. Yeah, very nice. Nice disco, it's great. Nice moves. You're going to be a hit tomorrow night. It's going to be huge for you. Anyway, when you get a letter like this from a prestigious guy like that, says, "I found some conceptual errors," you think, well, maybe I should just take the black capsule. Maybe this is, my life is over. But I read it carefully, which, you know, is an option. And he says that he thought I said that the reason the ocean looks blue is because the sky is blue. But he says, no, the ocean water absorbs red light. And that's why the ocean is always looks blue. So I gave it some thought and I wrote back to him. And if you'd like, take a look at the enclosed photos. So I sent him 11 pictures with some captions. And And there's the blue water from Hawaii. Now I scanned these photos not too long ago, so they've faded. The photos were, I'm sorry, to the young people. These were on film, which was a technology we had for storing, doesn't matter, don't worry about it. It's a long time ago. But if you look straight down at the water in Hawaii, it's really deep, and there's not the way the life that lives in the sea there is translucent, so the water looks blue. In this picture, you're barely 400 meters. You're barely a quarter mile from the shore, but it's still 150 almost 400 feet deep because it's a volcano, very steep underwater deal. And then just down the beach, you can see the blue sky reflected in the water, Professor Sagan. And in this picture, you can see gray, blue, and blue, and gray. You can see green and light gray. You can see white. You can see gray. You can see green. You can see the sky, the white clouds reflected in a puddle on the runway. And so this gave me... this gave me confidence. That's all I can tell you. All I can think he's a little bit of a hurry. And usually, if you're at sea on a ship in blue water, the blue color is because it's absorbing red light. But there's a lot of conditions where it's just reflected images either from the sky or from nearby greatly influential color reflecting objects. So then another thing I got involved in a couple years ago, Watts Up, do you know this? Andrew Watts, he's a climate denier. He criticized reasonably at first. Al Gore's video about climate change, which he put on the web on a thing called the Climate Reality Project. And Andrew Watt went on and on about, I put this up here just to show that there really were words and I really did quote it. But he talks about well-established science, and then he says at the bottom, this demonstration would be a completely different physical mechanism than what actually happens in our atmosphere. That turns out to be wrong. The reason this demonstration didn't work very well in the video for the Climate Reality Project was the top of the glass jar was too thick, soaked up too much heat, and the thermometer was too close to the top of the jar, and the globes that are in the jar to represent the Earth and its atmosphere just take up too much volume. And so there wasn't enough gas in there of any kind to influence the thermometers really in a reliable way. But what I found so troubling is the guy is, I think he knows better. I'm pretty sure he knows better. But he's a very popular denier. And this is, for me, of a piece. This is all one thing. That if you are going to deny science, it allows you to deny climate change. It allows you to deny that the moon does not glow with its own light and so on. But I just want to point out that when it comes to climate change, I go way back with this. There's a book I wrote back in 1993 that has a demonstration having to do with carbon dioxide. Then the science, look at the picture of what's, look how young that guy is. See, we are all time travelers, but we only go one way. It's becoming increasingly apparent to me, I have to say. The injury on the Dancing with the Stars show, I think it's a 57-year-old tendon being operated by a 17-year-old brain, and it just couldn't take the punishment. So that was in 1993, then 1995, I guess. And then a couple years ago, I did, push the button. A couple years ago, I did Stuff Happens, where we did the same demonstration, but now with very tall columns. We had about a meter of gas, and we had pure methane. And if you've ever been around a bomb, it is a concern, but we had these tops that would blow off if we did explode it. So anyway, the effect is actually pretty strong. You can fill the tube with pure methane or with pure carbon dioxide. If you let it sit for a half hour, 20 minutes maybe, with bright lights that are giving off light and heat, you will get the one with the pure greenhouse gas to warm up. And I remind everybody, it's a model. It's not proof of the paranormal. It's not the atmosphere. It represents the atmosphere. I mention this because it's part of the skeptical fight. It's part of the pro-science approach that we have to take. That we have to fight this fight. We are not going to change a lot of people's minds, but the young people especially, the people are going to be voters and taxpayers in the future. We really have to drive this home. Okay, I'll try this button. There we are. Yes, like different buttons do different things. It's new. So if you're not familiar with this, this is the temperature of the world represented on a graph over the last 1,000 years or so. And this is what's called the hockey stick. There's the shaft of the hockey stick. And then here's the blade of the hockey stick. So the problem, everybody, is not that the world is getting warmer. The world has been warmer than this. There's been more carbon dioxide in the air than this and so on. It's the speed. It's the rate at which the world's getting warmer. Try playing hockey with just a stick without the curve on the end, and you'll have a very different result. You need the curve on the end to play hockey, and you don't want the curve on the end if you live on Earth. So now this graph has been expanded not to 1,000 years or 2,000 years, but back 10,000 years through diligence, especially with ice cores, pollen in the bottom of lake sediments, I guess that's redundant, pollen and lake sediments, and the width of tree rings, and you can infer whether it was a warm season, a wet season, and so on back in time. And so it's no longer just the hockey stick with a bent shaft. Now these guys in climate science are calling it the hockey sickle, because the rate is so extraordinary, it's so high compared to what it has been in the past, the speed at which things are changing. And so everybody in this room, it looks like many of us are of a certain age where this will kind of be a problem. But to the millennials, many of whom are over here, okay, we messed up. And we've got to get on this. And so what should we do? Some more about me. In 1965, my family went to the World's Fair in New York City. And they had a total board of the U.S. population, and it was just under 200 million. And then not far from there, they had a total board of the world's population. And the world at that time, my family, especially my dad, brother, and I, were very disappointed because we missed it changing from 2,999,999,999 people in the world to 3 billion people in 1964, I guess. Well, now, if you go to the census, this is actually, these data are from yesterday. Yesterday, the U.S. population was almost 317 million, and the world population is now well over 7 billion. 7 billion people. So that's the problem. We have 7 billion people trying to make a living, where in my grandfather's time, there was about 1.5 billion. And we also have a problem of people denying science when we've got this issue. The Earth's atmosphere is thin, world's getting warmer, there's 7 billion people, and there's more of them all the time. What should we do? One thing that's been proposed is to run in circles screaming. I can't really run right now, but I can pivot in circles screaming. But that's probably not the best thing. Probably not. It's been proven ineffective. Now, has this ever happened to you, where you go to the White House, to the White House Science Fair, and the President of the United States comes up to you, "Hey, my kids love your show." If I may, how cool is that? Come on. He doesn't talk to me about, what is he supposed to do, world peace or science education? "My kids love your show. Great. Hey, Mr. President. Nice weather we're having." And so I propose that the key to resolving climate change to benefit the most humans in the world the fastest is education. Education is where I think this organization can really focus to, dare I say it, change the world. Yes, very nice. Yes, thank you. So if you haven't seen it, I've done these little videos about algebra. Algebra turns out to be this turning point in people's education. Apparently, the single most reliable indicator of whether or not you pursue a career in math and science, not a cause, it's not clear that it's a cause, but it's an indicator, is algebra. If you never embrace algebra or accept it, you're reluctant to think about a whole bunch of other things abstractly. So I did these videos about algebra. This is this bit where it's a film noir thing, and this letter came into my office. She was all leg with two arms. She called herself Y. Said she was looking for an unknown. And okay, but it was funny, all right. And so, did you meet anyone? Yes, I met this other letter on a big, what did he say? He said, two of him plus three would make me seven, and so on. It's hilarious. All right, and then we paved the floor of the studio with a giant piece of graph paper, and then we had two train tracks that represented straight lines, and we found a y-intercept and the slope of the line. And then I point out to the camera that if there were two toy trains coming at the same time, there would be a crash. And so wouldn't you know it, not too long after that, these two trains do show up and there's a crash. And there's little people standing around. And I asked the people there on the graph paper, are you guys okay? Yeah, Bill, we're made of plastic. It's hilarious. So here's an interesting thing that I came across that I'd like us all to consider. When it comes to something like algebra, when it comes to something like science education, in the U.S., there are about 100 million kids. It depends what you call a kid. You know, would you include, for example, my old boss? Yeah. There are about 100 million kids, and then about 100,000 grown-ups. And then the teachers of those kids, there's about 10,000. This is, think of it astronomically. These are orders of magnitude. These are powers of 10. And then the people that direct the teachers, all in all, at the national level in the U.S., it's only about 100 people. There's only about 100 people that direct education or direct teachers that influence kids, that influence our future. So I submit that if we can focus on those 100 people, and I guess it's mostly political campaigns, we can, dare I say it, change the world. Yes! Thank you. And just along this line, there's a mission, and in my business now, the word mission means spaceship. There's a rocket thing going to the planet Jupiter. And it's called Juno, and a very strange thing to me as a guy who's been in the space business, I used to work at Boeing, mostly on 747. Don't worry, everybody. When I worked at Boeing, I was very well supervised, okay? Just relax. There is a tube, though, in the Boeing, in the 747 horizontal stabilizer that I kind of think of as my tube. Just took me 3 years. It's this bit. That's it. That's very careful. Anyway, the strange thing about the Juno mission is it's not an acronym. It's weird. Juno was Jupiter's wife in mythology. And so this mission was launched in 2011, and it will arrive at Jupiter in 2016. And it just shows you how extraordinarily far apart these things are in space. And these, just to fill you in, you know, when you go to send a spaceship to Jupiter, and you're on a budget, you just got to buy a rocket off the shelf from, you know, Rocket Co. or whatever. And this is, so it's an Atlas V. It's pretty big, but it's not that big. So they sent this thing out beyond the orbit of Mars. This to me is just astonishing. Beyond the orbit of Mars, it fell back in toward the Earth and the Sun. And on October 9th, just 2 weeks ago, phew, it went around the Earth and on its way to Jupiter, except it's in outer space, so it doesn't make any sound. It just went on its way to Jupiter. It will arrive in the vicinity of Jupiter in 2016, and we did these series of videos, and it also once again addresses this great deep question, is there metallic hydrogen inside Jupiter? And people have said to me, well, why do you want to know that? What are you going to learn from that? We're not sure what we're going to learn. That's why we're going to have a look. And that fundamental idea just is amazing to me. Why are you looking for life on Mars? I mean, what would you do if you found it? Maybe we'll revolutionize medicine for all humankind for the cost of a cup of coffee per taxpayer every 12 years. It's such a value. So I hearken everybody to the Pioneer spacecraft. You may remember this. These were the first two. This was as Motown was giving way to disco, right before disco. Motown, disco, yeah. 1963. So these were the first spacecraft that had the plaques on them, where they had two naked people depicted. And then it was anybody, any alien could figure this out if you found it. I mean, obviously the thing, the dot there with the lines is our planet. And obviously that's a hydrogen atom that has a resonance. And so you just compute the binary number of resonances to the pulsars that would be in that orientation for that planet. I mean, how hard could it be? Nobody could figure it out. It's just hilarious. It's great. But we put it on there because when you put a note in a bottle and throw it in the ocean, I mean, yes, you hope somebody finds it, right? It would be great to get the note back, and you could think somebody in Britain or some exotic place found it and thought to send it back. Britain, it's back east. Don't worry, it's way back east. Don't worry about it. But the real reason you do it is for yourself. Oh, those phones, there's an Amber Alert, everybody. Amber Alert. But what are you all doing? Are you out looking? No. But it shows you how the man could mess with your phone. Doot, 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 doot. Anyway, when you put this note in the bottle, you can turn the phone off by putting it in an airplane mode. One of these people will help you. When you put this note in the bottle, you're doing it for yourself. And along with that, when we put this plaque on the spacecraft, oh, by the way, in this image, if you can see it, look closely, Pluto is still a planet. Still a full-fledged planet back then. I got no problem with Pluto not being a planet. Okay, this is going to go on the internet. Bill has no problem with Pluto not being a planet. It's smaller than the Earth's moon. It's probably got a lot of ice. If you put it where the moon is, most of it would, or a lot of it would evaporate. So instead of being the last of the traditional planets, for me, Pluto is the first of this new class of objects that I like to call the Plutoids. Plutoid, come on, that's cool. To be a Plutoid, that's living out there, yeah. But with that said, what I love about space exploration, what I love about these spacecraft that are sent to our solar system, is it's this inherently optimistic view of the future. That this is what humans can do. This is what this humble, kooky species can do. With all the trouble we have on Earth, all the climate change, all the crazy diseases, all the extraordinary political positions that we deal with, this is what humans can do best. This is what brings out the best in us. And by the way, for those of you who are scoring along with us, one of these spacecraft was sent east and west in the plane of the solar system, the plane of the ecliptic. And the other one was sent north, out of the north by Earth standards, out of the solar system. And there were several months or years where these two spacecraft were not as far from the Earth as people thought they should be, or imagined, or reckoned, or calculated them to be, by 400,000 kilometers or something, which doesn't sound like that far, but it's quite a ways. And it turned out to be that the plutonium battery, the thermoelectric generator, was giving off a little heat, and the photons going off the front of it are slowing the spacecraft down. It's really an extraordinary bunch of calculations, because it was done with the Earth going around the sun the whole time for the last 40 years. It's really crazy. So when I was in school, Carl Sagan talked about the Tunguska event in Siberia. And this was in 1908 in the modern calendar, the 30th of June in 1908. And it's so remote, how remote is it, that nobody was around when these trees were blown over. If you're here in the Northwest, look at Mount St. Helens. Trees blown over in an instant. But everybody in this room was alive, I think, as far as I can tell. Everybody was here for Chelyabinsk last February, where this meteor that nobody saw coming blew out all the windows, and everybody relaxed. So there was a meteor, cool, and they all kept driving and stuff. And then several minutes later, the sonic boom from that impact knocked out all the windows. And they asked Charlie Bolden, the head of NASA, what would you do about it if we found one tomorrow? He said, pray, which is an expression that means there really wouldn't be anything you can do about it. And I guess that means that, I guess at this meeting, that's especially compelling expression. Pray means nothing you can do about it. And the Planetary Society funds these people around the world to look for asteroids. And so this guy, Jamie Noman, in La Sagra, Spain, who's an oral surgeon and also an amateur astronomer, found this other asteroid, 2012 DA14, which was much bigger and came between us and our geosynchronous communication satellites. It was just a few hours later, like it got punked by Chelyabinsk. But this is a real problem. And everybody, we are the first generation of humans that could do something about it. We are the first generation of people that could stop an asteroid, could deflect it. And that's really sobering. Now, if you go to do that, you could fly, by the way, you don't want to hire Bruce Willis and go out there and blow it up. You don't want to, because you'll probably get a shower of things that could be even more troublesome if they hit in the wrong place. Oh, by the way, you know, the Tunguska event and the Chelyabinsk event both happened in Siberia, or that part of Eurasia. Because if you're an asteroid and you're going to come in from the north, I mean, Russia, or Soviet Union, used to take up 11 time zones. I mean, if you're going to come in from the north, there's a good chance you're going to hit Russia. Okay, so, but what if you don't? What if you hit Paris or some other interesting place, or Moscow, some other place that would be troublesome? So you could go out there with people and put a rocket on it and then, you know, turn on the rocket engine and give it a nudge, but it's in outer space, so it'd just be and give it a nudge. The whole question is, can you change its velocity, its speed and direction, just enough? So we at the Planetary Society, see, the whole thing is you just want to change its speed ever so, or velocity ever so slightly. If one of these things is going 20,000 kilometers an hour, you want to change its speed just 2 millimeters a second. That's all you got to do. And so we at the Planetary Society propose this armada of spacecraft powered by the sun that would pump lasers, that would zap the surface of the asteroid, and the stuff that's ejected, the ejecta, would have just enough momentum to give it a nudge. Just all we need is 2 millimeters a second. But we need time. We need 20 years to set these things up and get them out there. So when it comes time to vote, support the searches for asteroids. I mean, it could happen right now. And it's just been an extraordinary thing. See, does anybody have a Mac? It's like wipe for civilization. It's like what used to be control, alt, delete for a hard drive where everything goes away. If you let the Earth get hit with an asteroid, you know, that's it for civilization. And so it could be, this is a really interesting science fiction thing. Maybe the reason we've never heard from another civilization is they didn't have a moon and two superpowers emerge and declare the moon was the ultimate high ground and this is what we're going to do with our intellect and treasure for 10 or 15 years. And so they did not have a space program so that when an asteroid was detected, they couldn't get ready in time. And so all the other civilizations went the way of the ancient dinosaurs, but not us. We're ready, sort of, to do something about it. So when it comes to climate change, when it comes to population, when it comes to teaching the scientific method, I strongly believe we have to do everything all at once. It is very reasonable to me that in the near future we will have wind power and solar power. You know, if you could get all the wind out of North Dakota, you could power North America, including Canada and Mexico. You could power from just that one state if there was some way to get that energy from there to North America. I drive a Leaf, an electric car, a Nissan Leaf, and it goes about 100 miles. And then you got to plug it in. But it's very reasonable that in the near future, in the same way people know how many toilets are going to flush at halftime of a football game, Okay. It's another popular culture thing. Don't worry about it. In that same way, engineers will know where everybody's car is parked, at the shopping mall, at the hotel, at your place of business, at the factory. And so you could move electricity around, storing it in people's cars. It's an idea that's so crazy, it just might work. Then this emerging battery technologies, it is quite reasonable that these liquid metal batteries will work out. So this is where you've got one electrode made of antimony or antimony. It's next to tin on the periodic table. And then the other electrode made of magnesium, and they float on a layer of molten salt. And so the hotter they get, the better. So you just pump electricity into them and let them get hot, and they don't have the thermal limitations that most batteries have. And so in the basement of this hotel or convention center or Tacoma would be, the basement of Tacoma, there would be these enormous batteries that we would pump energy into during the day when the sun's out and at sunset and sunrise when the wind's blowing, and store it there all day. And then we'd send it all over the country, all over the world, on a smart grid. And Zach left, right? But he's going to Rice University. So I met Rick Smalley, who, unlike many of us, had a Nobel Prize. And he said, he's the guy, one of the guys that discovered buckyballs, Buckminster fullerenes, these crazy molecules of carbon. By the way, they were discovered by looking in space. They thought they were looking at carbon dioxide gas, but they realized it was this. He told the story in a really compelling way that he woke up at 3 in the morning and realized it was a sphere of carbon. He says, if you could stretch these things like this and make these tubes that were kilometers long, it's as though the electron goes to sleep at one end of the tube, has a dream, and wakes up at the other end with no electrical resistance. If you guys, if you young people could invent this, could make the better battery, you would get rich. You'd get crazy rich. You'd be like head of IKEA guy, rich. Bill Gates, you'd buy him. And so along this line, my skeptical friends, I just want to mention this while you're all here and we can move on. A lot of crazy ideas are being proposed, crazy, unusual ideas are being proposed for addressing climate change. So people have proposed building artificial, making reflective crops that would reflect sunlight into space. What you would eat as a result is not clear, but it's an idea. Or maybe you could breed certain food stocks that would be more reflective. People have proposed artificial trees that would take carbon dioxide out of the air. People have also suggested planting real trees. Wow, that's crazy! And then I got an idea. We're going to build a boat and we're going to throw fertilizer in the ocean. We're going to throw iron in the ocean. It's going to feed plankton, and they will take carbon dioxide out. Phytoplankton will take carbon dioxide out of the air. They'll sink to the bottom. That's going to be great. We're going to turn the entire ocean into a layer of pond scum. Great. No, we'll build these ships, and they're going to make clouds. And they'll pump water into the sky in clouds, and that'll reflect light into space. Dude, how big are these ships going to be? Have you seen a cloud? You know, they're quite large. I mean, yeah. Okay, I got it. We're going to have airplanes fly around and throw sulfur dioxide in the air, just like volcanoes. And that's going to reflect sunlight into space, just like volcanoes, and cool the Earth off. So you're going to put acid rain everywhere. That's great. No, I got it. We're going to put reflectors in space, giant mirrors in space. How well is that going to work? I mean, and how inexpensive is that going to be? And who's going to be in charge? Like, it's just not clear that any of these things will work. However, there are, as we say in the business, no bad ideas. So somewhere along the line, people are going to come up with ways to address climate change. And I predict, this is not extraordinary, that it's going to take what people call geoengineering. You're going to have to do things on a global scale. Now, a lot of people come to me with a lot of ideas. And this is an interesting one. And I can't tell if this guy is on it and is really has a great idea or if he's a little not on it with not such a good idea. But if you look at the wakes of these ships, they're white. They're full of bubbles, right? So the bubbles reflect sunlight into space. But along with that, once in a while, bubbles that are very, very small are created, so-called microbubbles. These are a few microns across, a few millionths of a meter across, a few thousandths of a millimeter across. And when you're a bubble that small in the ocean, with water with any sort of impurity into it, your world is not like you at the bottom of the pool swimming to the surface. The water is extraordinarily viscous compared to your size. So the bubble, I say you're a bubble, the bubbles persist for hours and days and even a week. And so it could be that you would generate bubbles of the right size and require all the huge ships, there are about 10,000 large cargo ships driving around at any one time, require all the huge ships in the world to have bubble makers that would be, I presume, regulated by the World Bubble Council. And they would make these bubbles and reflect sunlight into space. I mean, it's an idea so crazy, it just might work. Or maybe you just have ships drive around near the Arctic ice sheet and make bubbles right near the ice sheet so that the ice sheet would persist longer and reflect more light into space. This is one idea that just might work. And I mention it because you guys are here, and many of you are scientifically literate. And you know how you interact with the public, and especially young people. And maybe somebody will take this idea or something derived from it, and dare I say it, change the world. Yes, thank you. Now, when I was young, there was an artist named Gil Scott Heron, and he did a song before the term rap was coined. And it is a talking poem. And the refrain was, the revolution will not be televised because the people will rise up and take over the media outlets, and the man will not be able to control the people. But it turns out, everybody, the revolution is being televised. The revolution doesn't count unless it's on Twitter or Facebook. If it's not on Twitter, nobody believes you. The internet or social media have changed the world. And so it is possible, if we can harness the energy of young people and get them excited about the process of science, get them excited about the passion, beauty, and joy, the PB&J, of how we know our place in space, of how we have come to change the world in just a few centuries through the method of science. It is reasonable to me that we could, dare I say it, change the world. Now, for those of you unfamiliar with this picture, many of you are from the U.S. This is... No, but is there anybody from Canada? I mean, yeah, we're crying out loud. Lighten up, Americans. Wait, we are all Americans. Lighten up, U.S. citizens. NASA, National Aeronautics and Space Administration, paid for this thing. Sent a Cassini spacecraft out in orbit of Saturn. And by the way, fellow taxpayers and voters, it is literally being proposed that we stop funding this mission because it costs too much money. Now that you have a spaceship with a plutonium battery in orbit around Saturn, like, it'll never happen again in our lifetime. There'll never be another mission to Saturn. To even think to cut it off is just so nuts. There, that's going to go on the internet. My career is over. No, it's just such an extraordinary value. If you get a chance to vote for the Cassini mission, we should continue funding it. So this is a picture of Saturn. It's an extraordinary picture. The sun is behind it. It's illuminating the rings, if I may, from below, from the south. But if you're not familiar with this picture, let me point out, it is also a picture of the Earth. The Earth is right there. And it is a sobering thought. That's it. That's everybody you've ever met. That's every sea jelly, every oak tree, every phytoplankton, every old boss. Everybody who's ever lived has conducted his or her existence on that little speck behind the rings of Saturn. And if we were to go 100,000 kilometers up like in this direction or so, which in spacecraft terms is a day at the office, that's it. That's the Earth against the background stars. That's it. There's nobody coming to save the humans from the humans. I mean, this is our only place in space. And so it is with great joy and reverence and passion that I talk about the importance of science education for the future of humankind. When I was in third grade, Mrs. Cochran, third grade teacher, told us there are more stars in the sky than grains of sand on the beach. Now, I would not have expressed it in this way, but looking back, I was thinking, Mrs. Cochran, are you high? There cannot possibly be that many. Have you ever been to a beach, lady? There is nothing but sand. You look that way and that way, thousands of kilometers, there's sand. You shuffle your feet and there's more sand. The tide goes out even a little bit, there's more sand. Sand, sand, sand. And so as a kid, I'm standing on the beach and I realize that there probably are more stars than all of that. And I start to feel pretty insignificant. I mean, if you look at the Earth like this, where is Bill? Is he on the beach? He's no different from a grain of sand. He's just a speck. I'm just a speck standing on the beach with these grains of sand, which are just other specks, on a planet which really is just another speck, orbiting the sun, completely unremarkable star, day at the office star. I'm a speck on a speck with a bunch of other specks, orbiting a speck in the middle of specklessness. I suck. I am nothing. But with my brain, which is only this big, in the case of my old boss, must have been quite a bit small. But with your brain, you can imagine all of that. And so it is with our brains, my friends, with the process of science, with the passion, beauty, and joy of discovery, that we can, dare I say it, change the world! Thank you all very much. Thank you. So, oh gosh, I love you. Yes. Oh, cool. Oh, wow. Oh, wow. Thank you. Thank you. Wow. 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 Thank you, guys. Oh man, hold it, we gotta do this. Just sorry. Wait a sec. Yeah, if it's not on Twitter, it didn't happen, you know. Oh, thank you guys, thank you. Now, if we have any questions, there's a microphone.
Hi, this is not necessarily related to any specific thing you said, but a few years ago.
You fit right in.
A few years ago, Michio Kaku was on MSNBC. He made some remarks about how 95% of UFO sightings can be explained, but the 5% that haven't been explained shouldn't be dismissed. He said a bunch of other kind of dubious things, alluding to the fact that, or to the possibility that some of these UFOs are aliens and that they come from other dimensions. And I don't know if you've seen this YouTube clip, but...
Sir, if this were a game show... We would say, can you state that in the form of a question?
Yes.
So go ahead.
I when I saw this, I thought, what is he thinking? Do you know this guy? What is he thinking?
Michio Kaku?
Yes.
We're like this. No, I've had dinner with him. You know, he's a very good ice skater. Well, I think, you know, his deal is my interpretation of Michio, I call him Michio. Dr. Kaku, is he likes to provoke people. I mean, it doesn't bother him too much, the discipline of science and the imagination of science fiction. So what if 5% of the UFO sightings are unexplained? That does not imply that 5% of them are aliens. So it's provocative.
Well, that is
what
he
implied. So provocative, you're still talking about it. You know what I mean? Yeah. I'm very skeptical that we've been visited by aliens. And if you met the guy I used to work for, you might be more open-minded. But it's just not reasonable because of the distances in space. And you know, when I drive down the road, I see a lot of things in the sky I can't identify, but I'm not satisfied that they're anything but humanly origin or meteors streaking things from burning up rocks. Does that answer your question, sort of? Yeah? Okay, we'll go with a nod. Thank you. Yes.
Do you think we'll be sending people to Mars some point in the future, or do you think that, robots will be able to do it much cheaper and safer?
If I were king of the fittest, we would send people to Mars for two sort of divergent but fabulous reasons. What is everybody talking about? Is everybody talking about who is on the International Space Station? No, we're talking about the movie about people who might have been on the International Space Station because it's so personal. When humankind is involved, we have a story, and it changes us. You understand, just by way of example, former Soviet Union, the first space agency, had the first space agency to land softly on the moon. The first pictures of the far side of the moon. The first robotic sample return from another world. They brought back moon rocks by robot. But none of that is significant in most people's memory because when humans walk there, that's when everybody got engaged and excited. Along that line, for scientific, let's go with not only justification, but explanation, it has been estimated that what our very best robots do, run by our very best robots drivers, designed by our very best robot engineers, guided by our very best planetary geology scientists, what those robots, talking about the Curiosity rover, Opportunity rover, and Spirit rover, what those do in about a week, a human geologist can do in about a minute. So if you could get a human on Mars, you could make discoveries at a much faster rate. However, the cost of getting people there is extraordinary. And what it takes is international will. People have to decide it's worth doing. And what I will tell you, I mean, I guess till the as long as I'm alive, investment in space is this extraordinary value. It raises everybody's expectations of what's possible. And so the last number we got from NASA was every dollar that goes into space exploration pays back $3.60 in economic benefit. Now, there's a lot of argument, like roads, people say, well, that's 5-1. But we would not have this expectation of a better phone, a better computer memory, feeding more people with less water, less fertilizer, without the space program. How many people recognize jokes about global positioning systems? Oh, that sent me to Alaska. Because if you told my father we're going to plant seeds in a field within 7 centimeters with information broadcast from outer space, he would have thought you'd lost your mind. And yet, that's what we do all day. So yes, we want to send people to Mars. Yes, vote for it. But it's an extraordinary undertaking. It's a really hard thing to pull off. Yes.
James Ford, Saskatoon, Saskatchewan. My story is not unique when I say that you are almost singularly responsible for kickstarting my scientific literacy.
I love you, man. You're from Saskatchewan. Welcome. Welcome.
It was a 31-hour drive. Thank you.
Really?
Yeah.
That's dangerous, man.
It is. Yeah, no sleep.
It is.
I guess my question is a philosophical one for you, in that, for example, in grade 9, I had a lazy science teacher who would mess off to the faculty lounge and leave Bill Nye the Science Guy on educating us. Are you cognizant of the fact that you are responsible for that scientific literacy and potentially millions of human beings on the planet? And B, are you also cognizant of the fact that had you not done it, perhaps no one in your generation would have?
No pressure. Sir, first of all, thank you so much. I love you, man. Let me say that that really was the goal. I got to tell you, so just to talk some more about across the road from what is now Microsoft in Redmond was a company called SunStrand Data Control. Now, if they come back and sue me for my remarks, so it goes. But I was working for people who were obsessed with making money every quarter, every 3 months. And you can do that if you are making something like paper towels, which we do in Tacoma, paper products, where you have a market. And yes, you are continually trying to improve your paper towel. You're trying to outperform the other paper towel manufacturer. You come up with new ways to market and so on. But nevertheless, in parallel, you're manufacturing paper towels. You can do that. But when you're trying to make an inertial navigation system using laser gyroscopes for business jets, that would be 1/5 of the size of the competitive unit. You can't do that in 3 months. And so I just realized these guys were just, they were not about the future. And so I decided to try to influence young people. That was a conscious decision I made before I quit my job around October 3rd, 1986, roughly. I wanted to influence the future. And so, Guy from Saskatchewan, thank you so much. I hope that one of you or all of you go out to change the world, because I claim the scientific method is the best idea humans have ever had. And humans have had a lot of ideas. And so it's changed the world. Man, thank you. I hope you also will have this big picture view and maybe influence people. By the way, I have professionally, a lot of people think of me only as a kid show host, which is quite reasonable. But it's not. That's not a bad thing. You know, I say all the time, I meet Nobel laureates, and I meet a lot of rocket scientists these days. These are not necessarily the people you want teaching kindergarten. It's a different skill, and we need to value it. Yeah, thank you. Yes, sir.
So I am a high school sophomore.
Right on.
Go on. Okay. And like my predecessing question poser, I guess. I am starstruck by your influence, and you have been a major inspiration to me personally. But many of the people in my high school are not as passionate about science as I have been since I was very young. That is what I want to do.
Good. Well, it's going to be their loss. You're going to be the captain of industry. You're going to take over. Yeah.
Yeah.
So go get them. Better battery, better electrical transmission system. Change the world. Half of the humans are women, are female. So half of the scientists and engineers should be female. So get her done.
Okay. So I'm currently on my math and robotics team at school, but I was wondering if you had any advice, like for me and people like me, on furthering our pursuit of this interest.
Well, do you like robotics?
I do. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, pursue that.
I mean,
seriously, I became a mechanical engineer.
Logical.
Because I mean, I'm human, but I'm also a mechanical engineer because. I had this balsa wood airplane, and in the instructions it says if you bend the vertical tail, sort of make a rudder out of it, you can steer it. So most of the time when I wind it up, the rubber band, the older boys showed me how to lubricate it with dishwashing liquid. So you could really, man, I got like 350 turns in there. And most of the time you throw it, it would just crash, right? But one time it made three, this is an eyewitness account, okay, so you can be skeptical. It made three flat turns and came right back to my hand like a boomerang in a Warner Brothers cartoon. And I went, that's it, man. I want to work on airplanes. And so I bet you've had a moment like that. And, you know, robots are made by people. They don't just come out of the sky. So if you can make a better robot that's more efficient, you know, you could, dare I say it.
Yeah. Well, just before
I leave. So consider this just one last thing about robots. You know, the Japanese... It's made by Honda. Is it Akimo? Is that the guy's name? He's a robot, or she. What's his name? Asimo. Takes 500 watts to walk. A human takes about 330 watts to walk. Doot, 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 doot. There seems like there's a control theory opportunity in there. So go get them, man. Thank you.
Just thank you for being who you are.
Oh, no, I love you, man. God, you guys, this is great. This is, bring it on, because sometimes when I'm on Fox News, it's not quite the same vibe. Yeah. Yes.
Mr. Knight, it's an absolute pleasure to hear you. I also come from Canada. And
oh, you're from Canada? Do you know
Bob? Absolutely. He says hi, by the way. But I do see the battle that atheists are facing here, especially versus creationism in the States. And I'm afraid it's starting to seep across the border, and it's starting to come into Canada as well. And I'm quite concerned by the amount of apathy from knowledgeable people. So what would be your word of advice for these people that know better but seem to want to just sit by and watch the fight?
Well, the big thing I always say, at least in the States, is you got to vote. You know, if you if people don't want to vote, can they at least shut up? But Jeannie Scott just labors her whole life to get people to influence school boards who are nominally elected or put in place by constituents in the voting districts. So fight the good fight, man. And as I say, we're going to have to let go of a lot of stuff. Like that song at the baseball game, that's not going to happen. But if we can get young people excited about the process of science, I think we can head this off. And I just like to, just fundamentally, when it comes to evolution, it's the fundamental idea in all of life science. Just imagine doing geology without tectonic plates. I mean, you couldn't do it. Just remind people that it's a discovery, not just an idea. People, it's provable. Oh, well, I know you've heard the story. But we fight the fight. Come to this conference. Donate money at the end of the year. Or today. Yeah. Yes, next person.
Good evening. You mentioned that a way to revolutionize scientific education is by electing policymakers that appreciate its value, but of course these people have to be elected first. So how do we convince the voting public that these leaders need to be in office?
How do we convince the voting public? I hope you can figure that out. The next challenge in the U.S. is the voting districts have been gerrymandered. You know that verb?
Yeah.
They've been shaped to make it very hard for people not to get reelected. But it works both ways. You know, there's some districts are going to always be progressive, and they're unchangeable. So that's the first thing we got to work to. Well, not the first thing. A thing we got to work to reconfigure voting districts so that's more, it's fairer. But this is a long process. You should donate money to this organization and the Planetary Society. Say again?
I said I'm a bit low on cash.
Well, but right now. But
someday.
Yeah.
Someday.
But volunteer then. Seriously, spread the word. I mean, it's a long journey. You guys, we are, I don't know if we're in the minority, but our message is not that obvious to most people, that there is an alternative, that science is how we know the world. And people, when it comes to medical questions, everybody's fascinated with his or her body. People want the latest thing in medicine, but when it comes to other consequences of science, people are not always they don't always embrace it. It's a long journey. Am I right, people on the dais? Yes, it's a hard job. It's what we do all day. Just trying to change the world. So thank you. Let's take the next question. Yes.
I'd also like to say thank you for my beginnings in science.
This is fabulous. I love you guys.
I'm young enough to have seen your children's show, but old enough to remember your Almost Live days as well.
Yes.
I'm currently a science educator, and I agree with you that there's a population that we can't reach, and there's also a population like the one in this room that we don't need to reach. But as a science
educator... Yes, choir. Educator, thank you for listening, yep. Choir. Yeah.
As a science educator for adults, how do I reach those in the middle? What things can I do to help draw them in and
well, my
get
big
them
thing
passionate?
Is there's two questions that get us all in life. And if you meet people who have not asked these two questions, they're lying. That's all I got to say. Where did we come from, and are we alone? Are we alone in the universe? I mean, everybody has looked up at the night sky and just, I wonder if there's anybody out there. I wonder if the sky's blue on that person's world or that entity's world. So those two questions is how I love to engage people. And it really, that's where you really need space exploration, is where did we come from? I mean, there's a reason everybody thinks we have a common ancestor, and that's because DNA and so our logical thinking. And everybody has asked those two questions. So I would like to start there. Where do you think we came from? And if someone says, well, God made us all, well, why did she do that?
That's a good one.
And so on. That's a great question. Thank you.
Thank you.
Which I answered with two questions. Big way to go, Bill. Yes.
I was amused by your description of the bubble-blowing battleships. I wonder.
Well, battleships is good for that picture, but I think it literally would be cargo ships. But I know what you're saying.
Yes, thank I you. Understand they were merely examples of the concept. However, I'm just wondering if anybody has bothered to compute the carbon dioxide emissions from those huge motors in the ship.
This is a great question. So Russell Seitz is the physicist who promotes this, and it's not crazy. Or might not be crazy. He runs those numbers. There is an energy cost to producing the bubbles. But maybe somebody would come up with a way to produce the bubbles with less energy, with the right tribological friction surface that would do this. So that's, sir, you're hitting the nail on the head. Is the energy cost of producing the bubbles not worth it? But wait, let me ask you this. Suppose we could make ship fuel from plants. From, let's say, algae, then maybe you would have a nearly zero-sum game there. Maybe you'd have very little, the efficiency would be high enough that the extra carbon dioxide would not have as much effect as the bubbles would counteracting it.
You said you would make the ship fuel out of what?
Out of algae. People have bred algae. They've genetically modified it. Instead of making swamp gas, instead of making natural gas, they make oil, kerosene, diesel fuel. And there's several people competing patents to do this. And the people who really support this research is the U.S. Navy. The U.S. Navy's really interested in renewable fuels because of the strategic problems of getting oil in time of war. So it's another situation where your tax dollars are at work. Mm-hmm. And we have a strange situation to me where the military, which many of us think of supported as by conservative congressmen and senators, is very aware of climate change and working hard to address climate change, whereas certain conservative senators and congressmen are deny it. And so it is another chin stroker.
Thank you.
But
addressing
you've asked a great question. Is it worth it in an energy balance kind of way? Yeah. Yes.
Hi. I've been reading a lot of things by Jonathan Haidt recently. He's a researcher who posits that people form groups and then they get upset when things threaten that group identity.
They do not!
I'm bringing it up because I think the thing in Waco that happened, the thing with you in Waco, was...
Yeah, well said.
I think those people hadn't simply not been exposed to that information. I think they were hostile to it. And I wonder, basically, I think that we have to not only present people with information, but show them that it shouldn't threaten their identity. Do you agree or disagree and why?
Well, this is where I talk about the passion, beauty, and joy. I mean, if you can really get the idea that you and I are made of exploded stardust, that stars supernovae and create these heavy elements... many of them even numbered because the colliding hydrogen nuclei become helium nuclei. And then we are made of stars. If you can really take the time to imagine that and embrace it and not be filled with some sort of reverence, some sort of astonishment about our place in nature, that we are one of the ways that the universe knows itself, if that doesn't fill you with some sort of joy, well, I don't believe you. I mean, it's astonishing. It's wonderful. It just fills me with passion. And so this is what I like to share with people. But if you, but many people are brought up with this other tradition that doesn't embrace this process of reasoning. So I, you know, when one gets passionate, others might tune one out. Not that I would know anything about that, but I've heard. And so it's, I would say it's a process. Just share your path. Isn't it wonderful that we've learned all this rather than you're stupid, you don't know this? Yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah, thank you. Yes. Lead on.
So a lot of things that you touched on in your talk are my primary interest at school right now, namely how do we encourage scientific literacy amongst our electorate? How do we encourage good scientifically sound policy? And the urgency that both of these questions are imparted by the climate crisis. So if we live in this sort of ecosystem of people who are just learning about science, children, who then grow up to be people who may do science or may simply vote on things like, I don't know, food labeling laws or...
Well, food labeling is not unreasonable, yeah.
Because
you could influence consumers with information.
Right? Absolutely, absolutely. Right. I guess my question is, do you have any observations about where in society we should be exerting our efforts to ensure that science is promoted as well as possible so that we can make wise decisions?
This Jeannie Scott's life work is try to influence people on school boards to not mess things up. People who produce textbooks, people who produce science curricula generally know science, but we have an issue where we fight. The big thing for me is supporting elementary science education for two reasons. It's this thing that gets people excited about science before they're 10 years old, and the other thing is it's inexpensive. And if you want to engage kids, there's nothing cooler. I tell science teachers all the time, you got props. You know, you got things to play. You can blow stuff up. Come on. History teachers can't do that. Much as I love them. And so this is my mission. And as I say, we have to do everything all at once. There's just nothing that doesn't need to be done when it comes to science education. And by the way, this is why I work in space right now, or space policy, is because space exploration is unique. It inspires everybody. When you even make a movie about being in space, people go crazy, let alone if people are really flying to extraordinary new destinations in space. And so... so this is all of a piece. We're going to do everything all at once. How hard could it be?
So rather than concentrating on shifting curmudgeonly adults, we should work on our largest marginal gains are to be found in capturing the hearts and minds of children?
That's my opinion.
By blowing stuff up?
Yeah, well, that's my opinion. But
cool.
There's other people, you know, as my colleague, and really I've spent a lot, the guy's a dear friend, as Neil Tyson says, grown-ups who don't understand science who are in Congress are dangerous. I mean, I didn't write that. I mean, but they're very hard to influence, you know, or not understand, don't embrace it. And the big thing about science, investment in science from a government or federal standpoint, is the economic benefit. By investing in basic research, we invent things. We change things. When I was a young kid, laser was this invention without an application. But now there's lasers in your ballpoint pen. I mean, there's lasers everywhere. And so we would not have phones. We would not have computers. We would not have the internet without this investment in science. And by the way, everybody... I think everybody was here. Is anybody here born after 2004? Maybe one guy. A couple people. Anyway, in our lifetime, people went out to see how much the universe was slowing down after the Big Bang. Went out to measure the universe slowing down. This is going to be great. There must be enough gravity to slow it down. No, it's not slowing down. It's accelerating. And do you know why? Nobody knows why. And so it is very reasonable that in your lifetime it will be discovered and it will be perhaps a new source of energy that will certainly, dare I say it, change the world. So thank you. Thank you. Yes. Next questioner. So we're getting to the end of the line. This will be cool. All right. Thanks,
so,
everybody.
First of all, I would like to say that your goal of getting two children has actually worked. I'm proof of that. I grew up in a household where
to the microphone. You grew up in a household.
I grew up in a household where I was homeschooled because of my parents' religious beliefs, and your show was a bright spot in my part of my curriculum.
I love your parents in
thank
a way.
You.
Yes.
So my question for you this evening, you've actually touched on this subject a little bit during the queue. You've talked about people can influence policymakers through voting. What's something that people in this room can do on a more regular basis, like weekly or monthly, to kind of help?
Well, you could donate.
Something else you haven't mentioned yet.
Say again?
Something you haven't mentioned yet.
Did I mention CFI? Did I mention the Planetary Society? Because we advocate for space exploration and science education all the time. Volunteer at schools, tutor, you know, especially young people. Okay. And, you know, they're excited to learn. I mean, you guys, everybody, everybody's asked me the same questions. Bill, what are we going to do about it? And the answer is everything all at once. So get busy. But it's exciting. The process of science is exciting, and I claim it's more exciting than almost anything else you do in school.
So just one follow-up question. Do you find that contacting, like, you know, your congressperson or that thing, that, or those types of people, and making them aware of the issues that are important to you, does that actually seem to work?
Well, that's what I do. Seriously, guys, now as the CEO of the Planetary Society, I go to Congress, and an interesting thing to me is whether they're conservative or progressive. Everybody loves space, because especially if they happen to have a NASA center in their district, they're very interested in it. But everybody supports it because of the innovation that it leads to. You know, the country of South Africa has a space program. The country of Norway is launching its own ship positioning monitoring satellites because they know the value of having space engineers, space scientists running around in their country. It just raises everybody's expectations of what's possible academically and from a manufacturing standpoint. So let's do everything all at once, man. Whoa, man, let's go.
Thank you for coming to Tacoma.
Thank you. Oh, gosh. Tacoma is looking so great these days, I must say. You know, I kind of made a living on this comedy show in Seattle making fun of Tacoma, but, man, it looks great. No, it's great. It's fascinating. Yes. You're the last questioner. So this better be just rocking, man.
A little pressure.
I plan on changing the world, and I know that if we had enough time, you would understand how. And I was wondering if you could write a letter of recommendation for me.
My sense of the meeting is that I had better. Yeah, okay. Yeah, sure. Should I? Do you guys know this guy? Is he on the up and up there? All right.
My name's David.
Okay. Give me your information, yes, and we'll deal with it. Yeah. Oh, here we go. There's another questioner. Yes. Man in orange.
Hello, Ben Lai. I saw your movie at my school. Are you going to make any new ones?
So, am I going to make any new movies? Yeah, the ones about the Juno spacecraft are new. So you can go to Planetary, did I mention the Planetary Society? You can go to the website and there you can find them, and they'll show you why we are exploring Jupiter for the betterment of all humankind. Because we may make discoveries there that could, dare I say it, change the world! Thank you all very much, thank you. Oh, wow, this is great. Thank you.